Hello and welcome to this July edition of Cricket Monthly. There is a suspicion in various parts of the country that summer has arrived. We're keeping an open mind on that, but one thing we know for sure is that the fourth test starts tomorrow and England need to win it. My guest today is supposedly neutral, Stuart Law of Australia and Essex. We'll be talking to him throughout the programme. But first, let's see what else is coming up in today's show. Alex Stewart welcomes Andrew Flintoff to the England fold. Whilst a philosophical Nick Knight drifts away from it. We go to France to see if the French can win at cricket as well. We have Sir Garry Sobers in full flight 30 years ago. And he was back at Trent Bridge today. And the international umpires have been meeting in London.
There are many cheats on the cricket field. And the camera has shown many people cheating out there. So it's not a matter of what I am saying, it's a matter of what has been found out.
Some forthright views there from Steve Bucknor. And we'll discuss those in more depth later. But first things first, Stuart, that Benson Hedges win a couple of weekends back, that was remarkably easy for you.
It turned out that way, David, yeah. You know, it was a shame that the rain did force it into the next day, but fortunately for us, we came out on top.
You didn't have too many runs to your name in that one, but a couple of good catches, three good catches and a couple of wickets, one to finish it off with. So at least you contributed plenty.
Well, almost more catches than runs, so... It was just one of those things that you know, never really felt settled on the morning we batted. Paul Pritchard you know, batted extremely well, as did Nasser Hussain, but you know, picked up a couple of wickets, a couple of good catches, and we celebrated another trophy, you know, win 2 in 2 years.
Yeah, it's always nice to get the first one in the cabinet so early in the season. You're also going well in the AXA, aren't you?
Yeah, on top of the league now. We've got two games ahead of Lancashire, so... You know, they've still got to play another two to catch up with us, but we can only just do what we do. If we win every remaining game we've got, we've played three big games in a row now and come out on top of those. So, yeah, we're sitting comfortably at the top. Everyone seems to be up for it, and last night we you know, played brilliantly well to beat Warwickshire.
Yeah, it's not an easy place to win that, but as you say, you kept yourself at the top of the table. Just tell me one thing about that Benson's final, with all that weather around... And on the Sunday morning, when it looked as though it might rain all day. Now, what about the potential for a bowler? Because you must have known that had you gone to that, you're going to lose it.
It turned out that way. Yeah, we about 2 o'clock, I think, most of the boys went over to the nets out the back and we started rolling our arms over at the full three set of stumps. And I think our most successful bowler was Darren Robinson, who wasn't even named in the 12. So the bowlers who were going to be chosen were looking, you know, staring down the barrel of, you know, somewhat humiliation, bowling, you know, three stumps, missing the lot every time. But fortunately, the rain did stop, and you know, we got out there and, you know, finished it off the proper way.
Now, just over a couple of weeks ago, England clung on by their fingernails to draw the third test at Old Trafford. Alan Donald came ever so close to trapping Angus Fraser LBW, but moments later. England were celebrating with such enthusiasm that one thought they might well have won the match. Robert Croft defiant to the last. Now, heroic though Robert Croft's resistance was, the truth is that England had all but been defeated by an innings. And the selectors reacted as such by making five changes in their original 13-man squad. That squad was reduced to 12 this morning, with Robert Croft released to rejoin his county. Mark Butcher comes back in for Nick Knight. There are recalls for Graham Hick, Ian Salisbury and Alan Mullally. And Andrew Flintoff has taken over from Ben Holyoake in the role of precocious youngster. We'll have to wait until tomorrow morning to find out the final 11. But in the meantime, Steve May has been to Trent Bridge to assess the mood in the camp.
There was plenty of bounce in the England camp as they regrouped at Trent Bridge, but the harsh reality is that the side are still 1-0 down in the series with just two to play. Only Robert Croft's sterling back-to-the-wall efforts at Old Trafford a fortnight ago stopped South Africa from going 2-0 up in the series.
We're looking forward now. We underperformed in the first 3 days of that. Ren fought back very well to secure a draw, but now we start here all square as regards to the game. We're obviously 1-0 down in the series.
It was on a knife edge for a long, long time, but a terrific test match. The team, you know, battling for survival and coming through, if you like, that we were, you know, terrifically pleased with the result that we got in the end, which enabled us to go in with two test matches left and one down, which we would all be fully aware of what the consequences would have been if it had gone the other way.
England have made changes for Trent Bridge. Sarrazine Salisbury returns after a two-year absence, and Lancashire's new wonder boy, Andy Flintoff, could also make the 11.
Yeah, it came as a surprise. Things have been written in the papers, maybe I'd get a chance, but I didn't take much notice of them. When I did get caught up and the phone call came, I thought it was a wind-up.
And the call was on the bus to Oxford?
It was on Mike Watkinson's mobile phone on a on the way to a benefit game in Oxford.
Yeah. And do you think he thought he was winding you up?
Yeah, he said David Gray was on the phone, and all the lads were there. At first I wouldn't answer it. It took it, like, a bit of reassuring to answer the phone.
Well, he's come through the Development of Excellence programme, under-19s, and gave a good account of himself on the A2 last winter. Size of him, he's enormous. He's probably about 6'4", might be a little bit bigger than that, and in proportion, and 16 stone something, and he's a big lad. He's got big bucket hands, he can throw the ball well. He's a two- or three-dimensional cricketer, bats forcefully and strong, and bowls at a decent pace.
And some people are talking of you as the next Ian Botham. I mean, a few people have been talked of as the next Ian Botham over the years, haven't they?
Yeah, I don't think I'll be the next Ian Botham. I just want to be Andy Flintoff. If I do anything in cricket, I want to do it as me.
Another man back, the latest centurion of centuries, Graham Hick, after nearly a two-year absence. He'll bat at six because of Graham Thorpe's injury. But will we see a different Hick?
In the past, sometimes I've come to test matches not quite feeling as confident as I am at the moment. So I'd say that might be the biggest difference.
So it could be more mature Graham Hick, could it?
That seems to be the word everyone's using, so we'll stick with that for a few days.
England's final selection will depend on the pitch. It's the same one that was used for the test against Australia last year, with England hoping to avoid being rolled over by South Africa for one of their traditional batting collapses.
We know we haven't performed as well as we could have done, and we're working at it, and hopefully we'll correct it. Sometimes it does go that way. It's not just England. Other sides have collapses. We've just got to make sure it doesn't happen to us too often.
Stuart, I said at the start you're neutral, are you?
Well, I've got a couple of mates playing on the England side now, so, yeah, I'd like to say that I'm still neutral, obviously, when, you know, England being in England, you'd like to see them do well, because it buoys not only the English dressing room, but also the Essex dressing room. But, you know, it can work either way, yeah.
Well, OK, on that basis, how do you assess England at the moment?
I just think they're lacking a bit in the batting department, obviously. They haven't really made a great first innings total to put pressure on the South Africans in that regard, apart from the first test.
It's consistency, because, I mean, the first test, fine, they batted well, and then subsequently they've collapsed quickly in both test matches. That puts them under real pressure. I mean, what do you do as a batsman to achieve consistency?
Well, it's just a matter of, you know, believing in yourself, I think. Talking to Nasser about batting at Lords, he says that it's a wicket they don't really like playing cricket on, and yet he came out in the second innings, got 100. But he and after Alex Stewart got out, it seemed to be just a real disintegration of the batting lineup. But you know, Thorpe's been playing this year with a very bad back injury, and wonder if he hadn't played the whole series, gone away and got it right, you know, get someone in there like Graham Hick, who's been scoring a lot of runs. Whether it might have been a different story, but it's all ifs and buts. You never really know until it actually happens what could happen. But I just think England, they need to put pressure on the South Africans by scoring a lot more runs in the first innings, as they did in Edgbaston. And if Goffey hadn't have had his finger broken in that test, it could have been a different story altogether.
Now, how much do you reckon, though, it's players, or how much is it, for instance, the system they're brought up in? Because there are a lot of comments flying around about the state of county cricket, the quality of county cricket. How do you assess it as a visitor?
Well, everyone says, you know, you're being involved in probably the strongest domestic competition in Australia, the Sheffield Shield. People say over there, well, you go to county cricket and it's like club cricket in Australia. It's not that special. But, you know, there's plenty of talent going around the county circuit. I think the trouble is that there's a lot of cricket being played. And you get to, you know, the bowling in particular in county level, you get to a stage where the body just can't, you know, put out as much as it used to, due to tiredness. And, that's halfway through the season. So you get to a game and they tend to save themselves or let themselves go for the first session and then sort of just sit back in second gear for the rest of the match. But that only comes down to due to, the amount of cricket that's being played over here. And, as I say, there's a lot of talent over here, but it's just a matter of gaining consistency, which obviously is something the cricket board want to work on.
Yeah, and they need that tomorrow. The South Africans, though, might have been thwarted by the last wicket stand at Old Trafford. They must still be favourites for the series, 1-0 up with two to play. Chris Broad has been checking on their preparations.
After the frustrations of the draw in Manchester, South Africa have been on their travels. They've played against sides from Holland, Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland and have enjoyed the hospitality of the North East at Durham. They're now at Derbyshire, a mere underarm flick away from Trent Bridge. One man who won't be with the team is Lance Klusener. He'll not be returning to the squad because he's to undergo surgery on his injured foot. His absence, however, hasn't affected the preparation of the other players or even the spirit within the team, even after the disappointments of Manchester.
I thought we played pretty well there. It was obviously disappointing not to try and finish the game off. But if one looks at the actual statistics in the game, we were fairly much on top. And therefore, it's just disappointing not to win.
Making them follow on twice in two games is obviously a big bonus for us. And I think the important thing from our point of view has been the fact that we've batted quite well in the series. We came over here and it's probably the one area we wanted to work on. And so far, in all the county games and in the test matches, we've batted reasonably well.
I thought the bowlers were absolutely magnificent. Alan Donald, all of them tried their heart out. The wicket was very flat. Lance Klusener, unfortunately, was injured. That might have made a difference. But in the end, it was England played well enough to stop us from winning.
Klusener's place in the side should be taken by a fit again Sean Pollock. But with only 7 wickets and 30 runs in the series so far, he's looking for more success.
For myself, it's been a bit frustrating. Probably haven't got as many wickets as I'd like to in the test matches. But I haven't been unhappy with the way I've bowled. I got it to swing nicely, which was sort of important for me at the start of the tour. And hopefully the tide just turns and next time I play, I get a couple of nicks.
As Hansi Cronier leads out South Africa tomorrow in what will be his 50th test, he doesn't foresee any major team changes.
Yeah, I think we've played reasonably well with the combination we've had so far. And, barring one or two injuries, we're probably going to go with more or less the same lineup. Saying that, we're still going to have a look at the wicket and see what the conditions are like.
The Pollock family have many happy memories of Trent Bridge. In the second test of 65, Uncle Graham scored 125 in the first innings and 59 in the second. Father Peter took 5 wickets in each innings, ending with match figures of 10 for 87. Sean certainly has something to live up to.
Their combination was, I think, 10 wickets and 100, so if I can do half as well as that, I'd be pretty chuffed. So, it would be nice to keep the Pollock name going while at Trent Bridge.
Actually, I was there in 1965. It was my first test as a spectator, and I might add that on the next 2 occasions that I saw him bat, Graham Pollock again made hundreds. A wonderful player to watch. Now, the 4th test match starts tomorrow, a reminder there. England versus South Africa at Trent Bridge on BBC One. We have live coverage at 10:50 in the morning. For the first time, the National Grid, international umpires and ICC referees came together to air their views on the current state of Test cricket. They met at the Regent's Plaza Hotel last week and there were some pretty strong opinions expressed. Umpiring has always been a pressure job, even more so now that television cameras expose every mistake. That same technology is, of course, already harnessed to assist some decisions, and there are many who would advocate extending the role of the third umpire. It's a contentious issue, and even top umpires disagree, as Simon Hughes discovered.
There's no doubt being a test match umpire is an invidious task, with only one brief glimpse of confusing events before making a decision. At least now there's help. The third umpire, introduced in 1993, sits in a cubicle in the pavilion and can watch the same incident in slow motion before delivering the verdict. The third umpire is effective for line decisions like runouts, but is barely used for other dismissals, and mistakes, such as giving Mark Ramprakash out at Old Trafford, still occur. In umpire Peter Willey's eyes, he gloved it.
From what I saw, I gave an honest opinion, and after much television coverage, it was proved to be wrong. Well, we've got one angle. I gave leg byes to one that went down the leg side and hit Johnny Rhodes on the backside, I think. Now, the only way you could spot that was from the camera right behind the wicket. Now, there's no way on this earth I could have realised that. I knew he hadn't hit it. Alex Stewart wasn't too happy about the two byes, but that's just bad luck, really. We can only give what we see at the time.
Peter Willey was no shrinking violet as a cricketer, combating the most menacing bowlers in the world with vim and vigour, and he's equally uncompromising in a white coat. If total perfection is what we want, he says, maybe umpires should allow the electronic eye to be in complete control.
Let's have the television replay given decisions.
All decisions?
All decisions. Let's have cameras everywhere, so it can be, every angle can be covered. And depending how long it takes, we just stand there, have a drink, and stand around and until the man in the little room says in or out. It could take 2 or 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes. Now, do you make the time up at the end of the game, or is that counted in the 90 overs? I don't know. If we give it a try, and if the public and the players want it, let's have it.
Could be a 10-day test, I suppose,
well,
couldn't it?
It could be. They could, if you have 10 decisions, it would take three or four minutes each. You could end up finishing, out of goodness knows what time. But if everybody's happy, that's the thing, you've got to keep the players happy. If they're happy, let's try it.
Steve Bucknor was the first overseas umpire to stand in a test match in England. He believes that rather than extend television's role, the players should give themselves out more often.
It is my opinion that the television should not interfere too much, because there are times when there is the edge and it is not seen, it's heard. And if one should refer such a decision to the third umpire, he'll say not out, because he did not see a deflection. And there are so many times when there, you know, it does not appear as if there was a deflection, but the sound and, you know, technology would have failed the human element. So I do believe that it has reached a far stage. I hope that it will not go much further.
But you did say before that, but you did say that cricket is a slow game.
Yes.
Should you not allow batsmen to appeal to the umpire if they feel they've got an edge onto pad when they've been given out LBW?
Life is a cycle. We win some, we lose some. The batsman will say that he got an edge, but there are those who will cheat. And how do you say who's honest from who is not honest? So often you find a batsman will walk when the edge is a big one. When it's a small one, he won't. Or early in the innings, he'll not walk whenever he gets an edge. Later on, after he has scored 100 runs, 150, 200 runs, he walks. And he appears to be the good guy because he has walked. But on zero, he's not walking. So he's not really the good guy. He merely gives an impression to be the good guy. There are many cheats on the cricket field. And the camera has shown many people cheating out there. So it's not a matter of what I am saying, it's a matter of what has been found out. We have had people claiming catches when the camera has clearly shown the ball hitting the ground. So it's not necessary me saying, yes, he's a cheat. He has, I mean, so many players have been shown up to be cheating. And put it this way, I'm not saying all players, I'm saying some players. There are those bowlers, for example, who will appeal for a leg before decision. And when you say not out, in passing, he said, ah, going down leg. So he knew it was going down leg, yet he's appealing. So often we have players appealing for catches close to the wicket, knowing that the ball did not hit the bat. They call it gamesmanship. They are saying that they are putting pressure on the umpire to make good decisions. That is cheating, because if you know that the man is not out, why are you asking for him to be out? That has to be cheating.
Well, Stuart, very strong words there from Steve Bucknor. He's basically calling you all cheats.
It's very, very tough to call anyone a cheat, no matter what sport you're playing. I mean, it does come under the the line of gamesmanship, really. But it can get out of hand at times. No matter what level you play.
But I mean, you play a lot of cricket in Australia. Very tough cricket in Australia, where I've seen it down there. There's a certain contempt for umpires down under. I mean, you don't treat them particularly nicely down there. Where do you draw the line? What do you think is an acceptable line, as you say, gamesmanship or pressure? I mean, what's the word that we ought to be using there?
Mate, you're asking me to answer the question of the world in the cricketing sense, but it's one of those things where the umpires are out there, they've got to do their job to the best of their ability. Now, if they can't do it properly, well, I mean, it's always going to be the case. It's like a bowler going out and getting none for 100 off 20 overs. He hasn't had a great day. So I think the umpires have just got to accept that. They're going to have better days than others, which is the case with all cricketers. So, and the players, I mean, as players, we've got to sort of accept that the umpiring job is very tough. They're only human. They're going to make mistakes at times. And I don't think any cricketer in the world will want the third umpire adjudicating every decision.
I was going to ask, because, I mean, how much further do you think we ought to go? You can look at some of those things we saw on the screen just now, where there are balls coming off forearms. What do you think we should go to? I mean, should there be the right of appeal from a batsman saying, "But hang on, ump, do you mind asking your colleague in the box to check that, because it's come off here?" Or should we go towards saying, "Look, we've always accepted umpires' decisions as players. That's the way it must carry on."
Well, I think that's part of being a cricketer at the top level. You've got to cop it on the chin if you get a bad one, because you hear it so often that at the end of your career they tend to all even out. You'll get some decisions that go against you, you'll get some decisions that go for you. So it's just a matter of, I don't think that you should have to stand there and say, "Hey, just check that, I didn't hit that," or whatever. I mean, that's showing dissent towards the umpire. There's more respect for the umpires in England because they've all played first-class cricket. When you said before, the umpires aren't treated so well in Australia, a lot of them are school teachers or just guys who do a job other than cricket umpiring and haven't really played the game. So they don't really get the gist of a bat pad decision or the rules of the game. Obviously, they know the rules out of a book, but having played the game at the top level, you've got a better handle of the
laws. You sense that, don't you, as a player? Immediately, you've got an umpire who looks fallible. You're going to put pressure on, aren't you? Because it's in your interests to try and win that match by not by quite whatever reason, ways or means, but just by using that little fallibility.
Well, I mean, obviously the close ones, if it's close and, as a player you think it's out, well, of course you're going to appeal. Now, it's up to the umpire to say, yes, that's out, or no, it's not out. It's the guys who stand there and swear effing blind to the umpire and say this, that and the other. I mean, that's got to stop. Now, I've been guilty of that in the past, and I'll stick my hand up and slap myself on the wrist. But I mean, it's just got to stop. The umpires, they do get they get the rough end of the stick quite often from players, but that's just one of the things. I mean, they've got to understand too that we're out there trying to improve ourselves, trying to play cricket for our countries or do well in a respected competition. And there's a lot of passion in the game these days.
Well, if you offend again, we'll just have to send you back to Australia.
Yeah, no problem, yeah, like my ancestors.
It's not only umpires' decisions, of course, that players have to accept, but those of the selectors. Nick Knight was in the side at Old Trafford. 2 weeks later, he was back on the sidelines. Fiona Stephenson caught up with him as he took time away to reflect on it all.
Nick Knight is one of the best one-day cricketers in the world. He's one of the best fielders. He's passionate about his cricket. He's also very passionate about his food. Oh, Nick, we're just about to have lunch.
I didn't think you'd seen him.
Today's lunch was a mobile one at one of the only remaining restaurants in Warwickshire that Nick hasn't tried. We enjoyed a little jaunt down the River Avon, a perfect day away from the cricket. At the moment, Nick is averaging 50 in one-day internationals and 28 in Test cricket. He enjoyed a successful winter captaining England A in Sri Lanka and playing in Sharjah and the West Indies with the England one-day squad. He takes his cricket and his food very seriously.
Oh, that looks delicious.
So, Nick, my duck looks fantastic. Why have you gone with the soup?
Well, Fiona, during the cricket season, I'm afraid duck is not something I indulge in because about 3 or 4 years ago, I think your husband, John, and I was playing at Essex, and Nasser Hussain and a few of the other guys, we went for a Chinese, and we had this Bombay duck or whatever, and we all indulged in it, and then the next day we went out to bat, and there were four noughts on the scorecard.
All
the
so four, you're a wee bit superstitious.
All the four guys that had the duck.
How did your game plan for a test match differ from your one-day game plan?
Well, it's a completely different game, and my role within one-day cricket is to go and try and smack it in the first 15 overs and hit as many boundaries as I can and try and cause mayhem, really, in a controlled manner. Sometimes I don't manage that, but... And in the one-day game, in the test match, if we win the toss and bat, my role would be to bat for 2 days. So, and it doesn't really matter if I'm not scoring runs or boundaries as such, because if I'm batting, I'm going to pick up runs anyway. So it's a different mindset, really. It's a different approach. I guess people would say that I've mastered one or got a lot better at doing one than the other, but, I still believe, that I've got a big role to play in Test cricket, and I'll be more consistent.
Unfortunately, Nick hasn't been picked for tomorrow's Test at Trent Bridge, a huge disappointment after the thrill of his long-awaited recall to the last Test at Old Trafford, a chance that he didn't quite capitalise on.
Everyone has bad Test matches, and I had a bad one at Old Trafford, which is disappointing when you've waited, 14, 15 months to get back in. It's a real disappointment, but it hasn't sort of affected me. I'm just going to go out and play the way I can and do what I can and hopefully get another chance. I mean, I've missed out on this test match, which I'm really disappointed about. But I will just work as hard as I can to get back.
But you're also a fantastic fielder.
If you're a good fielder and a good catcher, I think it doesn't mean you get picked in the side of someone else who's a better batsman than you, but it gives you that sort of ability to become an all-rounder where you have another string to your bow. And also, it's a hell of a long time in the field, 110 or 90 overs, whatever game you're playing, and if you don't enjoy it, and you don't enjoy being out in the field all day and possibly 2 days, the last test match I played, we were in the field for two days and a half a session. That's a long time to be in the field if you're not enjoying it.
You're getting married in October. Is Trudy a good cook?
Fortunately, a hell of a lot better than I am. So I'm looking forward to spending lots of nice evenings in with lots of good food.
As soon as I hear you're not too hot on the main courses, let's start off with the garnishes then.
Okay.
I'm going to have a go at some cherry tomato flowers. So, first thing is to remove the green stalk.
Well, that's easy, I can do that.
The base is towards you.
Mine's a little bit more messy than yours.
I think the bowling's giving you heavy hands.
Hey? Mine looks like a crab.
Excellent, not bad for a first attempt.
You wouldn't know, would you? Which one's the pro? Oh dear. I think the look of this, I'll have to stick to eating. Let someone else do the cooking.
And next week we'll be slicing apples. It's competition time now. Last month your task was to name three prominent South Africans who played in county cricket. They were, firstly, Mike Proctor of Gloucestershire. Then Kenny McEwen of Essex. And finally, Nottinghamshire's Clive Rice. And the winner is Mrs. Anne Coleman of Seaford in East Sussex. She wins the bat signed by the England and South Africa teams, plus another mini bat signed by the BBC commentary team, and a replica of England's one-day international shirt. And five runners-up will each be receiving a copy of the new ECB coaching video starring Rory Bremner. This month, the challenge is to name these three English batsmen who scored test hundreds at Trent Bridge. Thank you.
That's a good shot. It's firmly clipped away, and that's going to beat the field through. That's it. It's a no ball. Firmly dealt with for four. He's absolutely delighted. His hat's raised in the air. Been acclaimed by the Union Jacks in the crowd.
Right, and you could win two tickets to the NatWest final with full hospitality and travel provided. Ring 0891 555 355 with your answer. Calls cost 50p per minute anytime you like, and the lines will stay open until August the 10th. And five runners-up this month will receive signed copies of Jonathan Agnew's book. Over to you, Aggers. Now, I know you were all watching the World Cup last month, so we thought if you can't beat them, join them. The French have a broad sporting culture of their own, not that one normally expects cricket to be part of it. However, Ralph Dellor popped over recently to find that cricket in France dates back further than we thought.
Cross the channel nowadays and you'll find that the French have a wealth of sporting achievements to crow about. Their rugby players rule the roost in the Five Nations, and their footballers rule the world after seeing off the Brazilians in the Stade de France. But in Lièvre in northern France, it's not rugby or soccer that's the talk of the town, but cricket. They've even named a road after the game in this quiet backwater in the Pas-de-Calais. And all because they found what's reckoned to be the earliest written reference to cricket, dating back to 1478. Apart from renaming Green Street Allée du Cricket, almost the whole village turned out to watch the unveiling of a commemorative plaque by the local mayor.
Alors pourquoi le cricket est arrivé à Lièvre? Dans les archives nationales a été retrouvé un document qui précise qu'un match de cricket a eu lieu à Lièvre en 1478.
Back in 1478, a letter of appeal was sent to Louis XI by a gunner Le Grant. It was in this letter that the mention of cricket was made, for the soldier had been watching a game in a meadow by the castle when a knife fight broke out and his adversary later died. 520 years on, and the scene has hardly changed as they prepare for a match to celebrate this little bit of cricket history. The cows have only just been moved off the field, if not all the cowpats, and there's evidence that the French underground is still operating.
You remember Sabina Park in January? Well, I don't think you'll get even an hour's play on this, despite the fact they spent a long time preparing this wicket. As you can see, they can only bowl from one end. All the batting will be done down on the coconut matting. And let alone facing Curtly Ambrose on this, I don't think I'd like to face David Gower.
It was the Kent 50-plus side which took the field somewhat warily to play against the French national team. And this being France, as well as a trophy, there was a bottle of wine at stake.
Qu'est-ce que vous en pensez du cricket?
Ben, je suis venue, c'est la première fois que je viens, je connais pas les règles, rien. J'essaye de comprendre en fait.
C'est pas très physique en fait. C'est pas très physique comme sport.
Comprenez-vous?
Non, du tout, non. Pas encore.
J'essaye de comprendre.
On essaye depuis tout à l'heure, mais c'est vrai que c'est pas évident. Hein.
Qu'est-ce que vous en pensez de cricket?
I'm English, actually.
So what's the possibility of cricket becoming just as much a part of the French rural scene as it is a feature of English life?
I think for it to take off, in terms of vertical takeoff, no, but it can gradually develop, and it's our job as administrators to give it the impetus to become, rather than a minority eccentric sport, something that at least most French people are aware of. And it can't do it overnight with cricket. Unlike most sports, it's an extremely complicated game to master and a time-consuming game as well, so you have to adapt it to the French way of living.
They've adapted well so far, having just gained promotion to the ranks of associate members of the ICC. They celebrated by beating the Kent team by 52 runs, and the French game might well receive a further boost from their footballers winning the World Cup.
Yeah, I think winning the World Cup, the Football World Cup, this will provide cricket, you know, help the cricket to go on, because this is, I think it's the same French cock which is winning, and this should help, yeah.
And the same blue shirt?
And the same blue shirt, yeah. Ali Libli.
And maybe in a good few years' time, French cricket will be world class, just like their footballers are today.
How about being an overseas player in France, then?
Yeah, it wouldn't be bad, would it? Yeah, looks all right. The outfield, yeah, come up a treat, doesn't it? Get the cows off and play your game.
Well, it's just like a country field in Queensland.
Oh, exactly, yeah. Out in the mining towns, you don't play on too much different to that, so... Yeah, I think they might struggle, though, if they came to a place like the Oval or especially down in Perth. But
yeah, but you might have to start to learn to drink wine instead of Forex.
Yeah, I'd have to become a wine connoisseur if that's the case. Overseas player in France, yeah. Appreciate the finer things in life, David, you know that.
I'll look forward to that. Earlier we saw England's newest recruit, Andrew Flintoff, a man whose reputation for big hitting was further enhanced a few weeks ago when he smashed 34 off a single over from Surrey's Alex Tudor. That was an eight-ball over, including no balls. So let's have a reminder now of how to achieve the maximum of 36 in just six balls. The feat was first performed 30 years ago at the St Helens Ground, Swansea, and the man doing the striking, none other than the great Sir Garfield Sobers.
That he's got to pick. That was the right distance. He's hit that out of the ground. Way up, many a mile, past the pylon there, over into the road to the old cricketers. That's another one. Goodness gracious me, that peppered the top. You see the chap climbing up there to have a look over the wall. That peppered another hotel on the other side of St Helens. A magnificent shot, picked it on the up. All in to do with a few fielders stuck on the top of that wall over there. That's another one up in the enclosure. The last person we saw hit like this is Marjorie Jahangir in that wonderful knock against Glamorgan a year ago. Ooh, he's got the shorter one. It's up again. There it is, bouncing on the... Bouncing on the concrete, 4 sixes in 4 balls. And that will just carry. Now he's going to be out. Caught out. Oh, he's dropped it. He's over the boundary. Now, what? Where's my glasses? Somebody pinch my glasses. Let's have a look. Roger Davis is asking. Chaos here. Roger Davis caught it, but he doesn't know whether he fell over the boundary or not. The umpire's going across to have a look. Now the players are joining in. Six it is! 5 on the try. And he's done it! He's done it! And my goodness, it's gone way down to Swansea. 6 on the trot. 36 in one over. My goodness gracious. What an over. What a batsman.
Sir Garry, as I'm sure you were aware, despite the black and white film, was wearing the Notts colours in those days. And he was back at Trent Bridge today to open the magnificent new stand at the Radcliffe Road end.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sir Garfield Sobers.
And I'll be in our new commentary box in that stand tomorrow. Everything looks good and the preparation's well underway there at Trent Bridge. England's Test side may be struggling at the moment, but their under-19 team are currently world champions, and they're back in action again soon. The 13-man squad has been announced for the one-day internationals against Pakistan. It'll be captained by Middlesex's Oes Shah, and includes, amongst others, Stephen Peters, Stuart Law's colleague at Essex, who we saw in that B&H final, and Ben Spenlove, who made a name for himself as the substitute fielder for England in this summer's first test. The first of those one days is at Harrogate a week tomorrow, followed by two at Chesterley Street. Entry is free to all those games. Now, Stephen Peters, colleague of yours, how good's he going to be then?
Very good, yeah. He's a young kid. He's very keen to listen and learn. He asks questions about the game, which is obviously a great way to learn the game of cricket. And you know, he's put in some useful performances for us this year, got us through to the Benson Hedges Cup final. So he's going to be a good one, yeah.
So England under-19 seem to be doing all right. Now, tell me, yourself, you're suffering the odd injury nowadays. You had a blow on the ribs yesterday, was it?
Yeah, blow on the ribs. It had me bat and went home type of thing. Just bruising, went for x-rays last night. There was no break or fracture found, which is a good sign. But next Tuesday I'll go and have an operation on my shoulder, just arthroscopy, which will put me out for 2 to 3 weeks, hopefully.
So not too long a break, but just enough to get through the summer.
Well, just enough to get through, yeah, and get myself right for the summer back home. Of course, we've got leading into the World Cup next year. I want to be able to give myself every chance to make that squad. And if I don't, well, I think the writing's on the wall for Stuart Law.
Yeah, I mean, how disappointed are you not to have played more for Australia?
Well, as I said in a couple of interviews, it's been hard growing up, trying to out-bat the guys like Mark Waugh, Steve Waugh, Alan Border. Three top names in world cricket. Very hard to push those blokes out of a test side.
So if you don't make it this time, that's about it then, you reckon?
Well, never give up, but I think the writing's there. Unless an opportunity comes down the road, which you're always hopeful of in a position that I'm in, injuries can happen to blokes at different times. So hopefully, not hoping that someone gets badly injured, but you never know. It might be an ounce of luck in my favour, go my way, play another test match.
OK, well, we wish you well.
Cheers, mate.
Now, just a reminder that you can catch up with all of today's cricket on CFAX or via the regular updates on Radio 5 Live. And the Cricket Focus will be on Saturday again in Grandstand on BBC One. That's it for this month. My thanks to Stuart Law. Hope those injuries are sorted quickly. Don't forget to tune in tomorrow morning at 10:50 on BBC One for live coverage of the fourth test. And if you feel like sending us an email on whatever topic takes your fancy, please do so to gcm@bbc.co.uk. I hope you'll join us tomorrow. Till then, goodbye.